Fast food and telly chefs are, however, mere symptoms. They aren't the causes of these islands' gastrocultural bereavement. The British can, after all, write, engineer, explore, film, die, philosophize, dig, invent, compose, act. But the British can barely cook. They are unfamiliar with raw products. There are historic reasons for this. The first reason is the enclosures, which is merely the empowered's euphemism for its appropriation of common land. Anywhere that was of agricultural or silvicultural use was nabbed by the aristocracy. That meant most of Britain. The geological and topological complexions of this country are peculiarly susceptible to industrial agriculture. The land is seldom precipitous, rarely mountainous. It's thus appropriate to large-scale production. It is not by chance that the earliest implements of industrial agriculture derive from Norfolk, which has become the exemplar of all Britain's agriscapes. It is increasingly prairie, an outdoor factory without a roof, and no hedges to prevent the dissipation of topsoil. Agri-industry not only produces muck, it is not only an aesthetic blight, it is too environmentally degrading. The pursuit of short-term profit is already leading to long-term destruction. Greed and green are a single letter and many miles apart.
Henry went into the family regiment, cashiered, I'm afraid. Jamie went into the city, spot of bother with a serious fraud squad. Tim took orders, defrocked, the usual, I'm afraid. Me, I'm the eldest. And all that you can see is mine.
The second cause of this country's agricultural structure is primogeniture, by which an estate is left in its entirety to the firstborn. This form of inheritance means that more and more land is owned by fewer and fewer people. And the more land you own, the greater the advantage can be taken of economies of scale. Britain eats to live rather than lives to eat. We regard food as mere sustenance. We suffer the hangover of Protestantism, and the idea of the John Knox cookbook is laughable. Food is something post-Protestants feel guilty about. Denial still permeates our culture. The stuff we shove in our bodies points to a collective self-loathing. Britain, incredibly, uses the words wicked and sinful to describe chocolates.
Burger. Ketchup.
Looks like we lost him. Check if he's got a kebab donor card.
The paradox is that for all our grim pragmatism about food and our antipathy to its pleasurable potential, we in this country suffer the highest incidence in Western Europe of dietetically derived illnesses. And we're rapidly catching up with the United States of America, which is world leader. We eat negligently. We choose to eat that way. We don't suffer droughts or famine or crop failures. We suffer, on the contrary, the consequences of plenty, circulatory and cardiac diseases, cancer, diabetes, and most manifestly, obesity. This is something I have knowledge of, having been diagnosed as morbidly obese. It was that morbid that prompted me to do something about it. And it's something that you have to do yourself. No amount of governmental propaganda from DEFRA, from the Food Commission, from the Health and Safety Executive can persuade us. Indeed, the incidence of dietary-related diseases seems to increase in direct proportion to the amount of health policing that we're subjected to.
Tell me this, how do you keep the toppings on your pizza if you didn't deep fry it? And Mars bars melt. Did you consider that?
Obviously not.
Doing things I used to do, they think I'm
good. Fast food, slow suicide.
Next on Ready Meals Night, how a postman and a gardener took on a fast food giant and won. McLibel, in a moment.